to all. From 3:15 to 5:15, Dr. Janakiram sir will be handling the session. So Dr. G.D.Janakiram is currently the Associate Professor in the Department of Metallurgical and Materials Engineering at IIT Madras. So his education details are, he completed his Master's and PhD in Metallurgical and Materials Engineering at IIT Madras in 1998 and 2005 respectively. And his employment details are, starting as Assistant Metallurgist in Navbharat Ferro Alloys in 1993, he went on to become as a Senior Project Officer in the Department of Metallurgical Engineering in IIT Madras in 1998. From 1998 to 2005, he was a scientist in Regional Center for Military Airworthiness in Materials Division, DRDO, Hyderabad. From 2005 to 2008, he was a postdoctoral researcher, adjunct assistant professor, Department of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering, Utah State University, US. From 2008 to 2013, he has been as assistant professor in the Department of Metallurgical and Materials Engineering at IIT Madras. From 2015 to 2016, he was a visiting professor in the Department of Industrial Engineering, University of Louisville at US. And his research interest includes welding, additive manufacturing, adhesive bonding, and laser-based metal deposition. So he holds 4 patents. That patent details are, he holds a US patent in laser-based metal deposition of implant structures jointly with Justin from February 2010. He also holds a US patent in laser-based metal deposition of antimicrobials to implant surfaces in May 2011. And also he have applied for a US patent in surface roughness reduction for improving bonding in ultrasonic consolidation of rapid manufacturing. Apart from this, he has also been a principal investigator for many sponsored and consultancy projects for various organizations, which includes ISRO, IGCAR, ARCI Hyderabad, National Institute of Ocean Technology, Bell Bharat Heavy Electricals Limited, and industries which includes GE, Alstom, JSW, Webson, Wiston, and Chennai Petroleum. So now I invite Dr. G.D. Janakiram sir to deliver the lecture.
So good evening to all of you. I thank Ramesh for that kind introduction. It's too elaborate, really. I'm very happy to be here. I thank the organizers for inviting me here. Today I'm going to talk about some new possibilities with friction deposition and friction stir processing. In this talk, I'm going to emphasize more on the ideas and the overall outcomes, rather than dealing with very finer details of this work. All this work is published, so I'll be going to show some references. So I encourage all of you to look at those papers if you desire to know more details about these investigations. Many of you are familiar with friction stir processing. Essentially, in this process, we use a rotating non-consumable tool to cause severe plastic deformation at high temperatures in the base material. This is essentially friction stir welding, but the idea here is to achieve a certain microstructural modification in the base material. The intent is not really to join two materials. The intent is to achieve a certain microstructural modification. So the schematic is very illustrative. You can all understand that. In the past, friction stir processing has been proposed and demonstrated for a number of different purposes, as listed there. You can use friction stir processing for producing ultra-fine-grained materials. During friction stir processing, the material is subjected to severe plastic deformation at high homologous temperatures, at high strain rates. Consequently, the material undergoes dynamic recrystallization and develops a very, very fine grained structure. In friction stir processed materials, grain sizes of the order of 1 or 2 micrometers can be readily achieved. And if you employ some rapid cooling techniques, for example, processing underwater or processing with a spray of liquid nitrogen behind, you can achieve even nanometric grain sizes. 200 nanometers, 300 nanometers can be readily achieved with these enhanced cooling techniques. Such ultra-fine-grained materials have excellent strength in combination with ductility, and also they are good for superplastic deformation. So there have been a large number of publications on the use of friction stir processing for producing bulk ultra-fine-grained materials. Secondly, friction stir processing, again because of the severe plastic deformation, results in thorough homogenization of the composition. So any compositional variations in the starting material can be completely removed. So it is well known that in cast magnesium alloys, similarly in cast aluminium alloys, we have extensive interdendritic segregation of alloying elements, and these are not good for the properties. So friction stir processing can be carried out to even out the compositional differences. Thirdly, friction stir processing can be used for repair. If we have a defective component or service damaged component with a crack, the crack can be completely healed by processing that region. Similarly, we can add some reinforcement particles into the plastically deforming matrix during friction stir and achieve either surface composites or bulk composites for producing materials with high wear resistance, for example, high strength and high wear resistance. The other one is very interesting. When we do friction stir welding under wrong processing conditions, we end up with a tunnel defect, right? And this tunnel runs all along the length of the weld. So it can be advantageously utilized for passing a cooling fluid through a very complex channel, right? And if we deliberately achieve a tunnel defect in a complex configuration, then we can use the channel for passing a cooling fluid so that the component can be cooled very effectively. And this is patented by Professor Rajiv Mishra, and it is called friction stir channeling. So all these are very well known. Then finally, friction stir technique can also be used for cladding as well as additive manufacturing. For example, you have the base plate, on top of it, place a sheet of material and then successively friction stir process or friction stir weld. And that is friction stir cladding. And if you keep on doing it layer after the layer, you build a three-dimensional structure. Of course, the layer shaping here is by CNC machining. So material addition by friction stir welding, and layer shaping is by CNC machining. All these are well demonstrated, and the feasibility has been well established. I'm not going to talk about any of these things. We will see what more can be done with friction stir processing. A related process is friction deposition, and many consider friction deposition as the forerunner to friction stir welding. Friction deposition or friction surfacing was originally developed in Patan Welding Institute, Russia. And for many years, it remained dormant. And after the success of friction stir welding, it started assuming significance. This is a very unique technique. Normally, weld cladding is done using fusion welding processes, where you have many difficulties such as dilution. This is a solid state process. In this case, a consumable rod is used to deposit a coating. The consumable rod is rotated against some substrate under some axial pressure, and friction generates heat at the interface, plasticizes the consumable rod material, and as it is traversed along the substrate, you leave a metallurgically bonded coating behind, and the width of the deposit is roughly equal to the diameter of the consumable rod. And we have now very high capacity friction deposition machines where you can use even 100 millimeter dia bar to achieve a 100 millimeter wide track of material in just one pass, right? Here you see a picture of a friction deposited martensitic stainless steel on mild steel substrate. And here you see the cross section, the deposit 440C, alloy 440C deposit is very nicely bonded to the substrate. And there are many advantages with such solid state deposition. Firstly, you achieve strong metallurgical bonding without melting the substrate, so there is no dilution. Then, because you are not melting the material, there are no issues with solidification, cracking, porosity and other defects. Then, the residual stresses in the cladded plate are very minimal because there is no solidification event once again. Then you achieve really good microstructure because this is also a severe plastic deformation process at high strain rates and high temperatures. So you once again see very fine dynamically recrystallized wrought microstructure. This is in contrast with as solidified cast structure of a fusion weld clad, right? So this is a very interesting process, and in our lab at IIT Madras, we have done a lot of work using friction surfacing in the past, and some of the references are shown there. Now, an extension to friction surfacing is additive manufacturing using friction deposition. And again, a lot of work was done in the last 6-7 years in my research group, demonstrating the feasibility of additive manufacturing with friction deposition in multiple ways. You can deposit material line-wise. For example, you deposit material track by track, side by side to produce a layer, and then it is CNC machined to shape. Then friction deposition occurs for the next layer. After completing the next layer, again, do CNC machining. Keep doing this until the entire part is built. This is line-wise multi-track friction deposition, and that is how one can produce three-dimensional parts. There is also another way to utilize friction deposition for building layers one over the other without involving translation motion. So in this case, the consumable rod is rotated against the substrate. There is no movement anywhere. And after some friction time, the rod is simply lifted. As you lift, you see a deposit underneath, right? And this deposit is very strongly bonded to the substrate. And then it is surface machined, and then the next layer is deposited. Keep on doing it until the entire part is built. Again here, material deposition occurs by this friction process, and layer shaping is achieved by CNC machining. These are some of the references by one of my prior students, Mr. Dilip. Now, I'm going to talk about some new possibilities, extensions to these ideas. utilizing both friction stir processing and friction deposition. One idea is to make use of friction deposition for additive manufacturing of novel metal-metal composites. We will see what are those. And the second one is to utilize friction deposition as a buttering technique to facilitate dissimilar metal welding, as well as to improve heat-affected zone liquefaction cracking during subsequent fusion welding. And the third idea is to utilize friction stir processing again for improved heat-affected zone liquefaction cracking. And importantly, the last one is very interesting, that is selective alloying. Use of friction stir processing for selective alloying. So you locally want to alloy a certain region, either to achieve higher strength or higher toughness locally. And these are the contents of this talk. I'm going to show you five different case studies. Once again, I will emphasize on the ideas and the overall outcomes. I'm not going to go into very fine details. This work is published again by one of my students, Karthik. And the idea here is to produce a metal-metal composite with a good combination of strength and ductility. Metal matrix composites are known for quite some time. Traditionally, you have an aluminium matrix or magnesium matrix, and the reinforcement phase is a ceramic, like silicon carbide, alumina, things like those. These exhibit very good strength, hardness, but they have one fundamental problem. Toughness and ductility in these composites is very poor. That is one of the reasons why these composites have never really gone into industrial applications in a big way. There is a very good improvement in strength and wear resistance. But for an engineering material, you also need good ductility and toughness. Otherwise, that's not a good material, right? So, a fundamental problem with conventional metal matrix composites is poor ductility and toughness. And this is due to the fundamental differences in metals and ceramics. The reinforcement phase is a ceramic. It is never going to bond very strongly with the metallic matrix. They are entirely different systems. And secondly, ceramics have very low coefficient of thermal expansion. Metals have high coefficient of thermal expansion. So at the interface, there is always some stress, which facilitates very easy crack initiation and propagation. So no matter what we do, in a conventional ceramic matrix reinforced metal matrix composite, we are not going to see good ductility and toughness. What is the solution? The solution is to use a metal as the reinforcement. That's how the concept of metal-metal composites has come up. So you use a metal like titanium as the reinforcement in aluminium. Similarly, a metal like nickel as the reinforcement in magnesium, things like those. This is good because metal-metal can are more compatible. The coefficient of thermal expansion is not that widely different. Then you can have good bonding at the interface depending on what kind of reinforcement, what kind of matrix you are talking about. But then they are not that easy to produce. Conventionally, ceramics are ceramic particle reinforced. Metal matrix composites are produced by stir casting technique, which is a mature process. Stir casting is the standard process for producing ceramic reinforced metal matrix composites. For producing metal-metal composites, such techniques are not suitable. We cannot really succeed with adding titanium particles in an aluminium melt and achieve a composite, because titanium will immediately react with the aluminium liquid and form brittle intermetallics. It dissolves. So we need to have special techniques for producing such metal-metal composites. One of the possibilities is to friction deposit them. That's the basic idea behind which we started working on this, right? Now, if you think a step further, there are now some very interesting systems like high entropy alloys. These are multi-component systems with something like 4 or 5 elements in equiatomic proportions. These are popularly known as high entropy alloys, and they have some very interesting properties. They are very strong, hard, thermally stable, and their reactivity is very low. They don't allow any other elements to diffuse into them fast. Diffusion within the high entropy alloy is very sluggish. All these characteristics make them very attractive for reinforcements in metal matrices, right? So, how about using high entropy alloy reinforcement? Because of their attractive properties like high strength, toughness, wear resistance, then by nature they have low diffusivity and reactivity. So we may be able to add these particles in, let us say, aluminium matrix in large amounts and be able to achieve a composite with very high strength as well as decent ductility. That was the idea. When we think about this, immediately a lot of questions will arise. For example, how do you introduce these particles into the plastically deforming material which is getting friction deposited? And if you do it somehow, whether the distribution of the reinforcement particles will be uniform or not is the next question, right? Whether the layer bonding will be proper or not. As you introduce these reinforcement particles, the layer bonding between individual layers can get affected, right? So that is another question. Then, if we utilize nanocrystalline high entropy alloy particles, typically these are produced by mechanical alloying method, ball milling, and high energy ball milling. If you do that, the particles are nanocrystalline, which is even more attractive, right? Nanocrystalline, high entropy particles uniformly distributed in a matrix. Whether we will be able to retain nanocrystalline nature of these starting high entropy alloy particles, that is another question. Because during friction deposition, there is going to be significant heating. Temperatures during friction deposition are as high as 0.8 homologous temperature of the consumable rod material. And such high temperatures can destroy the nanocrystalline structure of the reinforcement particles, right? So that was another question. Then what happens, what if intermetallic formation occurs severely and we have no benefit in terms of strength or ductility? It is very much possible, right? We have to worry about all this. And finally, after doing all this, whether we really be able to achieve a good enhancement in strength without serious compromise on ductility? All these are the questions. So we did, with all this in the background, we carried out some experiments using aluminium magnesium alloy 5083H112 as the consumable rod, standard 5083. And we used cobalt chromium iron nickel high entropy alloy powder produced by ball milling. So this is by mechanical alloying method. And the crystallite size of these high entropy alloy powders is about 10 nanometers, and the average particle size is about 15 micrometers. Here you see a picture of these ball milled powders, and here you see a micrograph of the polished powders, where you can see loosely bonded powder particles, right? These are like weak agglomerates. So when we estimate powder particle size using a laser particle analyzer, we are bound to overestimate the particle size, right? But during friction deposition, because the process involves severe plastic deformation, many of these loosely bonded particles are going to get broken, right? Which is not bad for our purpose. The finer the reinforcement particle size, the better, right? So then, how do you introduce the reinforcement particles into the plastically deforming matrix? We came up with a very simple technique. That is, you drill some holes in the consumable rod, as shown here. For example, you have one hole here, another hole here, here, here at the center, and the hole has a certain size optimized for the volume fraction that we want to achieve. We were looking at something like 12 volume percent high entropy reinforcement in aluminium magnesium matrix. So you drill some holes according to a certain configuration and fill these holes with the high entropy powder and then carry out friction deposition as schematically illustrated here. So you deposit a layer, machine it flat and even, then deposit another layer, machine it flat and even, keep on doing it until you have a sample of sufficient height for undertaking all the mechanical tests. We were looking at tensile tests in Z direction, that is along the build direction, right? So that again is illustrated here. You produce a multi-layer friction deposit, slice it and extract tensile specimens and assess the properties. Okay, here you see a cross section, longitudinal section of a 40 layer friction deposit. Each layer is about 1 millimeter in thickness, so the height of the deposit is about 40 millimeter. And here you see, okay, you can make out the layer interfaces vaguely because of the edge contrast. We don't see any defects anywhere. Everything is nicely bonded, and the layer thickness is quite uniform from bottom to top. Here you see a low magnification backscattered electron image where you see the high entropy particle reinforcements in brighter contrast. The dark background is aluminium. As you see here, particle distribution is very uniform. Particle size is more or less uniform. There are, of course, fine particles, somewhat coarser particles. But then, in a particle reinforced composite, something like this is quite impressive. As you see here, the average particle size is 5 micrometer, and the interparticle spacing is 8 micrometer, which is quite close. And this can actually tell you one more thing. From here to there is one layer, about 1 millimeter. And you cannot really distinguish the layer interfaces. That is how well the layers got bonded. And you also see at the layer interfaces, there is no accumulation of reinforcement particles. If all the reinforcement particles get accumulated locally here, for example, that would actually affect the mechanical properties. So in this case, that did not happen. Now, whether there is any diffusion of alloy, whether there is any elemental diffusion from the matrix into the particle, and similarly from the particle into the matrix. And we don't want to see too much of diffusion across this, right? And we did some EDS maps of various elements to see that absolutely there is no diffusion of aluminium into the particles, nor diffusion of any of the constituent elements in the high entropy reinforcement like chromium, nickel, iron, cobalt into aluminium. That is very impressive. Then we looked at the interface microstructures in transmission electron microscopy and the interface between HEA particle and aluminium matrix is very clean. There is no intermetallic or reaction product at the interface. So that is again very encouraging. And then we did selected area diffraction on the high entropy particle to get these ring patterns. And these ring patterns tell you that the particle is still nanocrystalline. So we are really getting a very good microstructure in the composite. The nanocrystallinity is retained. Reinforcement particles are very fine and uniformly distributed. Then there is no accumulation at the layer interfaces. The volume fraction is about 12 volume percent, which is what we intended to achieve. So far, so good. But what about matrix microstructure? We found that during the process of friction deposition, the matrix microstructure also gets benefited very significantly in many ways. For example, if you do EBSD, you see very fine dynamically recrystallized grains with a high fraction of subgrain boundaries, which is good for a which is good for mechanical properties. Then the second phases are refined, as you see here. All these are broken fragments of second phases originally present in the starting consumable rod. This is aluminium magnesium consumable rod, so it is very typical to see relatively coarse aluminium magnesium intermetallic particles, magnesium silicon intermetallic particles, similarly iron aluminide particles, magnesium manganese aluminide particles. All these get fragmented into fine pieces and they get uniformly distributed. So that's again a good feature. You see very small grains here with fine uniformly distributed second phases in the matrix. And some developing cells are shown there by arrows. So overall, we have an excellent microstructure of the matrix characterized by very fine grain size and a high fraction of subgrain boundaries and fine and uniformly distributed second phases. So if all these are put together, we should be seeing a good improvement in strength without a serious compromise in ductility. And that's what we found in tensile test, in Z direction tensile test. We found a good improvement in strength compared to the starting consumable rod 5083H12. There is something like 100 MPa increase in both yield strength and ultimate tensile strength. There is a certain drop in tensile ductility, but that is understandable because you have a large fraction of reinforcement particles. This is, after all, a particle reinforced composite. And we found that the strengthening mechanisms in this composite are both load sharing as well as dispersion mechanisms. There are many fine high entropy particles uniformly distributed in the matrix, so they contribute to dispersion hardening. On the other hand, relatively coarser high entropy particles share the load with the matrix, right? So overall, I can say this friction deposition technique is very attractive. It's capable of producing really interesting composite materials. So with that, I close on this topic and get into another topic, that is use of friction buttering for fusion welding of dissimilar metals. Again, this is a published work. Now, many of you might have heard about buttering. It is essentially deposition of a compatible material on One or both of the base metals prior to joint preparation for fusion welding. So you take a plate of base metal, on the edge do buttering and then do actual fusion welding. Buttering is a very commonly used technique in dissimilar welding, especially dissimilar ferrous metal welding. For example, take cast iron to steel joining, right? Welding of cast iron to steel. Cast iron has very high carbon content, and if you directly weld cast iron to steel in the fusion zone, you are going to get a lot of carbon, which will present solidification cracking problems as well as very high hard martensite, and that will also crack by cold cracking and other phenomena. So directly cast iron cannot be welded to steel. So what is done is, you first deposit a layer of nickel on cast iron and then do fusion welding with steel. This nickel is very ductile, it accommodates all the stresses, and importantly, it will not allow carbon to diffuse into the fusion zone. It is a barrier for carbon diffusion into the fusion zone. So such examples are abound, the use of buttering in dissimilar metal welding. It is used for overcoming cracking problems. Similarly, it is used for avoiding undesirable diffusion of alloying elements like carbon. And importantly, it is also used for resolving post-weld heat treatment related problems. For example, in power plants, there are always some joints between 9 chrome 1 moly type steels to austenitic stainless steels. After fusion welding, the 9 chrome side needs a post-weld heat treatment, otherwise it is too brittle, it develops a martensitic microstructure in the heat affected zone. It must be tempered and stress relieved. If you temper at something like 650, 700 degrees centigrade, that is going to harm your austenitic stainless steel. It causes a lot of different problems in austenitic stainless steel. So how do you resolve this problem? The answer is, you first deposit an Inconel material on P92 base plate, do your post-weld heat treatment. This post-weld heat treatment does not harm Inconel butter material, and then do fusion welding with austenitic stainless steel. And after fusion welding with austenitic stainless steel, you don't have to do any post-weld heat treatment. So this is kind of now going around the problem. We resolve the post-weld heat treatment issue by buttering the P92 or P91 material with a nickel layer, right? If you consider all this, this buttering technique looks like now very, very powerful. It is indeed powerful, but not very useful for dissimilar metal welding. I'll tell you the reasons why. For many dissimilar metal combinations like steel and titanium, you don't really see a compatible third material. There is no compatible third material. If you want to fusion weld steel to titanium, there is no butter material to rely on. So in many cases, there is no solution provided by buttering for this reason. Because for many dissimilar metal combinations, there is no compatible butter material available. You cannot really come up with such a thing. Secondly, this buttering is also done by fusion welding, right? As you do fusion welding, as you do fusion buttering, in the heat affected zone, all kinds of problems happen in the base material. For example, heat affected zone liquation cracking can occur, grain coarsening can occur, hard microstructure can form in the base material, right? So after buttering, many times you have to do a post buttering heat treatment. For these two reasons, or these three reasons, buttering is not the universal solution for dissimilar joining. It is very useful only in specific situations, in specific contexts. but it cannot be applied everywhere. One main reason for this is that you are depositing the butter material by fusion welding technique. But if we can deposit the butter material by solid state methods, like friction deposition, our life becomes simpler. That's the idea here. Why we consider friction deposition for buttering is because of all these reasons. Again, it's a solid state process. There is no melting, there is no dilution, heat affected zone, base material thermal damage is very minimal. Then the butter, the buttered plate has very low residual stresses. You can get away with the post-buttering heat treatment. And intermetallic formation is less problematic, so you have wider options for butter materials. Now, the concept is schematically illustrated here. You take a, the idea is to join base metal A to base metal B by fusion welding. Prior to fusion welding, base metal A is friction buttered with base metal B or any compatible metal C, right? You deposit a layer of material in sufficient thickness and then prepare the edges for fusion welding. Use filler metal B or C to produce the fusion weld. And when you do that, the heat affected zone on the base metal A side falls within the buttered region. In one sense, you are removing the dissimilar metals from each other and reducing a tough dissimilar metal welding problem into a routine fusion welding task, right? For example, if you imagine friction buttering of metal B on metal A and then use a filler metal B to weld metal B to friction buttered metal A, it is like basically welding metal B to metal B, right? You are reducing the dissimilar problem to a routine similar welding situation. That's the idea here. And to see how effective this approach is, we have considered two test cases. One is fusion welding of austenitic stainless steel 304L to a borated stainless steel, ASTM 304B4. These borated stainless steels have important applications in nuclear industry for neutron shielding application. This picture here shows the microstructure of the borated stainless steel. It has large number of borate particles, iron chromium borides, and these chromium iron borides are very brittle and also have a low eutectic melting temperature. So when we, this material is not fusion weldable. If you do fusion welding of this borated stainless steel, in the fusion zone you see a continuous network of gamma boride eutectic, which is very brittle. So it has very poor ductility and toughness. More importantly, it is susceptible to solidification cracking. Then, in the heat affected zone, the borides undergo liquation, leading to cracking in the heat affected zone. For all the three reasons, the borated stainless steel is not fusion weldable. And if you weld with 304L stainless steel, in the fusion zone you have the correct boron content to cause very severe cracking. In these stainless steels, the cracking susceptibility increases with boron content up to 0.68%, and with further increase in boron content, the cracking susceptibility reduces because of backfilling effect. But if you autogenously weld borated stainless steel to austenitic stainless steel, in the weld fusion zone you have the right boron content for severe hot cracking. So that cannot be done. So that is one tough test case. Secondly, we have chosen an aluminium copper alloy to aluminium zinc magnesium alloy 7075. Many of you know in aluminium copper a little bit of magnesium can cause very severe cracking, hot cracking again. Similarly, in aluminium, zinc, magnesium system, little bit of copper can cause very severe cracking. So if you want to autogenously weld aluminium, copper to aluminium, zinc, magnesium, in the fusion zone you have a highly susceptible composition and it only cracks, right? And if you want to really fusion weld such a composition, you must use aluminium silicon filler. And if you use aluminium silicon filler, the joint efficiency is very low, typically less than 50%. For this reason, this combination again is a very challenging test case, right? Now we are going to see how effective the friction buttering solution is for these two test cases. We have deposited austenitic stainless steel 304L in 6 millimeter thickness on borated stainless steel, right? And then electron beam welded it to austenitic stainless steel. And when we do electron beam welding, it is like welding austenitic stainless steel to austenitic stainless steel. So no problems whatsoever. Why it is similar, simple austenitic stainless steel electron beam welding, right? And you see the micrographs here. This is the micrograph of the friction buttered 2014 alloy. And this is the micrograph of the fusion zone with skeletal delta ferrite and little bit of lathy ferrite. And here you see the interface between friction buttered 2014 and, this is austenitic stainless steel. So this is friction buttered austenitic stainless steel on borated stainless steel. And when we did tensile testing of this joint cross weld specimen, we found that failure occurred just outside the friction buttered interface in the borated stainless steel base material. And the joint efficiency is nearly 100%. And you see the typical stress strain curve here. So a tough dissimilar joining problem of austenitic stainless steel to borated stainless steel is reduced to a simple austenitic stainless steel to austenitic stainless steel fusion welding. So this approach here is really successful. And the second test case is also good. We deposited aluminium alloy 2014 on aluminium alloy 7075. And then electron beam welded to 2014 base material. Once again, good microstructures everywhere. But there is one small concern in this case. When we friction deposit aluminium alloy 2014, the temperatures experienced by the friction deposited material is something like 450, 470 degrees centigrade. That can seriously overage the deposited material, right? The aluminium, the strengthening precipitates, Al2Cu, theta prime precipitates, undergo very severe coarsening. So we have that issue in the friction buttered region. So this is in an overaged condition. And when we do electron beam welding, a thin region adjacent to the fusion zone further overages. Right? That was the issue. If you do hardness survey across the weld, you find that in as welded condition, in the friction butter 2014 region, the hardness is very low, right? And when we did tensile testing in as welded condition, the strength was not so great. We were only getting 260 MPa yield strength and something like 330 MPa ultimate tensile strength. The ductility was also not so good and fracture occurred exactly adjacent to the fusion boundary in the overaged heat affected zone. And the poor ductility in this case is because of the composite nature of the tensile sample, you have large number of different regions, 7075 base material, 2014 base material, then 2014 butter deposit, then overaged heat affected zone, then fusion zone, right? Because you have all these regions in the same specimen, deformation gets concentrated in the weaker region. So you have fracture occurring with relatively less overall tensile elongation. Knowing that this is overaged, if you do direct aging, that will not solve the problem. So you only have to go with a solution treatment followed by aging if you have to improve the properties further. So that's what we did. We did solution treatment of this weld at something like 500 degrees centigrade, and then subsequently the entire weldment was aged at 175 degrees centigrade. After that, there is some improvement in hardness in the friction buttered region. That means this region is getting stronger. But we found that in the friction buttered region, there is abnormal grain growth. And this abnormal grain growth is because of the inhomogeneous deformation within the friction deposit. It is, it's a complex phenomenon, but that was the problem. We have abnormal grain growth in the friction buttered deposit. Now, if you look at the weld cross section, you see 27075 here, 2014 there, abnormally grain coarsened friction buttered region, and then fusion zone. And when we did tensile testing, the strength was decent, 350 MPa yield strength, something like 475 MPa ultimate tensile strength, and the joint efficiency was more than 90%, but fracture occurred again in the abnormally grain coarsened friction buttered 2014 region, right? Here you see the fracture. And so the results are not all that bad. We are still getting something like 72% joint efficiency in as weld condition. And if you do post weld heat treatment, solution treatment followed by aging, joint efficiency is even better, but probably that's not the right solution, right? Because it is causing the abnormal grain growth in the friction buttered region. It is possible to achieve better results by modifying the solution treatment, as we have shown here. This is again the macrograph of a 2014 multi-layer friction deposit. And if you do standard solution treatment, which is 500 degrees centigrade, 2 hours water quench, using a relatively fast heating rate, there is abnormal grain growth, right? And this can be avoided by modifying the solution treatment cycle. For example, you can do heating to 400 degrees centigrade, soak for something like 1 hour, then raise the temperature to 500, then soak for 2 hours, then water quench. If you do that, the abnormal grain growth problem can be minimized. So better results are possible even with the dissimilar joining case between 2014 and 7075. If we adopt a heat treatment cycle like this, right? So overall, I can say the use of friction buttering for dissimilar joining is very very interesting. It appears to be very capable, really. And the third case that I am going to talk about is the use of friction buttering for improved heat affected zone liquation cracking. And again, the idea is illustrated here. Why do you consider that friction buttering can improve heat affected zone liquation cracking? For two reasons. First thing is, the friction buttered region exhibits a very, very fine grain size. And we know fine grained materials can offer greater resistance to heat affected zone liquation cracking. And secondly, during friction deposition, any low melting second phases in the material get fragmented and they get uniformly distributed. So you don't have these particles occurring exactly on the grain boundaries leading to cracking. For these two reasons, it is an interesting approach. Now, if you consider something like this, take base metal A, you want to weld base metal A using fusion welding. And before that, friction butter it with the same base metal A or any other metal B, right? Subsequently prepare the edges. Here is the friction buttered region, which has a very fine grain size. And you prepare the groove like that and then do fusion welding. When you do fusion welding, the heat affected zone is contained within the fine grained buttered material, right? And this fine grained buttered material has a good microstructure characterized by fine grain size, uniformly distributed low melting second phases. So you can expect to see good improvement in heat affected zone, liquation cracking resistance. Now, if our interest is only in producing fine grain size here, can we not achieve this by friction stir processing? Friction stir processing also produces ultra fine grain size, right? Indeed, it is the right technique to consider for relatively low strength ductile materials like aluminium, magnesium. But friction stir processing of high strength, high melting point materials like nickel based alloys, titanium alloys, stainless steels is a challenging task. You need to use very high end friction stir tools. And even if those high end friction stir tools, the processing depth cannot be very high. So the technique is limited to relatively thin sheets, right? Whereas here, with friction buttering strategy, even high strength materials in thick section size can be readily buttered. Therefore, compared to friction stir processing, friction buttering can provide an excellent method. It is a good alternative to friction stir processing for relatively thick, high strength base materials. Now, to test this idea, we have used superalloy, nickel-based superalloy, Inconel 718, and the composition is listed there. It has 5.3% niobium. It is a gamma double prime strengthened superalloy, and the optical and SEM micrographs of the solution treated superalloy are shown there. 1080 degree solution treated nickel-based superalloy. We call it reference material from now onwards. You see it has some carbide particles. The grains are relatively coarser and it has relatively low fraction of low angle grain boundaries. That's typical of a standard rot processed Inconel 718. Now we did Gleeble hot ductility test on this material, samples extracted from this reference material. We did not carry out the entire test scheme. We were only considering nil strength temperature as the basis. So we did Gleeble hot ductility test. Nil strength temperature was determined as 1250 degrees centigrade for this reference material. So as you heat to 1250 degrees centigrade, profuse liquation occurs in the material so that it fractures without any strength, without any ductility. The load that you have to apply to cause fracture is very little. That is why it is called nil strength temperature. Ductility, of course, is zero, because as you heat to 1250 degrees centigrade, there will be extensive liquation of the grain boundaries. So the material cannot bear any load nor show any ductility. Now, We did multi-layer friction deposition of this inconel 718 material and extracted specimens for nil strength temperature testing. Here you see a low mag picture of the multi-layer 718 deposit. There are some shear bands at the interfaces, but that is not very important for our current discussion. And you see a very fine-grained microstructure here. EBSD micrographs show the grains very clearly. And in the shear bands, we have still finer equiaxed grains. And the presence of these shear bands is not really an indication of improper bonding. Bonding is quite good. I will not be able to go into the details of shear band, but the microstructural features are standard for a multi-layer friction deposit in inconel 718. Now, the grain size is very, very fine compared to the starting consumable rod, right? And then the carbide particles have undergone some fragmentation, so there is some refinement of the carbide particles as well. Importantly, the subgrain boundary fraction is much higher in this because it is a dynamically recrystallized material. Here you see a subgrain boundary very clearly, right? Now, if we see the microstructural characteristics, we should be expecting a significant improvement in heat affected zone liquation cracking resistance. In other words, if these microstructural features are really true, we should be expecting a higher nil strength temperature for this sample. That's what happened when we did global hard ductility test. The friction deposited material did not fracture upon heating to 1250 degree centigrade. That means the NST temperature is still not reached, so it is still higher. That's the first indication that the friction deposited material has higher resistance to liquation cracking. Then we looked at the microstructures. In the reference material, we found extensive secondary cracking adjacent to the fracture line, whereas in the friction deposited material, there is no secondary cracking at all. And if you closely look at the microstructure here, you will see extensive liquation, resolidified lavice phase along the grain boundaries. Whereas here, those indications are not very prominent, right? And if you do electron microprobe analysis for various elements in the regions adjacent to the fracture line, you see that niobium segregation, extensive segregation of sulfur, phosphorus, as well as boron in the reference material. And in the friction stir processed, friction deposited material, there is no serious indications of sulfur, phosphorus, boron segregation. All this basically tells you that the friction buttered inconel 718 can exhibit much higher liquation cracking resistance as compared to standard processed inconel 718. So that straight away answers our question. If you friction butter inconel 718 with inconel 718 and then do fusion welding, you achieve much higher cracking resistance. The fourth case is, again, as we were considering, use of friction stir processing for improved heat affected zone liquation cracking resistance. And this work is again published. We have considered a magnesium alloy AZ91, magnesium aluminium alloy AZ91 for as the test case in this work. This alloy AZ91 has about 9% aluminium, and if you look at the microstructure of the as cast material, you see extensive beta interdendritic phase, right? This beta phase is magnesium 17, aluminium 12. So what you are seeing here as a network in bright contrast is beta phase. And it has also a small amount of Mg2Si interdendritic phase. And if you look at these regions at high magnification, you also see some secondary beta precipitation in the interdendritic regions. These chunky ones are the primary beta particles, and these fine script-like features are correspond to secondary beta, right? Both are detrimental for heat-affected zone liquefaction cracking resistance, because this beta phase has a very low eutectic melting point. So when we attempt fusion welding in the heat-affected zone, these beta particles would undergo liquefaction, forming a continuous liquid film along the dendrite boundaries, leading to cracking. Our idea was that when we use friction stir processing, we refine the grain structure, break and redistribute the low melting second phases, and also destroy the segregation patterns. Right? And the idea here is to do friction stir processing of the base plate prior to fusion welding. It's like a pre-treatment. Then do fusion welding such that the heat affected zone is contained within the friction stir processed region. And we have covered all these things. And in the EDS maps here, you see extensive segregation of aluminium and zinc to the interdendritic regions. Now, when we do friction stir processing and look at the microstructure in the stir zone, we see very fine equiaxed grains, small broken beta phase particles, primary beta particles, broken into very small pieces. And the grain size is about 8 micrometers. Then the eutectic beta fragmented particles have a size of 5 to 10 micrometers. Mind you, in the starting ash-cast material, the beta particles are more than 200 micrometers, 250 micrometers in length, right? Almost like a continuous network along the interdendritic regions. But here we have very fine primary beta particles. Interestingly, we found that in the friction stir processed material, we have secondary beta phase particles precipitated on the grain boundaries. This is, of course, not very disturbing because these are very fine. As you heat the material to high temperatures, these would undergo very quick dissolution. For example, if you look at this DSC thermogram, this is the line for friction stir processed material. This is the line for starting ash cast material. Because in the ash cast material, you have beta phase occurring in large size, very coarse particles, dissolution is not that quick. So you don't see any dissolution endothermic peak corresponding to beta phase dissolution. But in the friction stir processed material, you see a prominent beta dissolution peak here. That means by the time you hit the liquefaction temperature, most of the beta phase is dissolved. And that is also evident here. This corresponds to start of the eutectic melting. This is end of eutectic melting. The start is around 420 degrees centigrade. End temperature is around 435 degrees centigrade. Of course, these temperatures are sensitive to the heating rate used for the DSC experiment. We used a heating rate of 5 degrees centigrade per second in this experiment. You see, this endothermic peak corresponding to eutectic melting is very, very prominent as compared to the small eutectic melting peak in the friction stir processed material. I would like to take some water. So, what I am saying is, we see a lot of secondary beta precipitation on the grain boundaries. But this is not really a concern as far as heat affected zone liquefaction cracking is concerned, because these are very fine and they are anyway going to get dissolved in the heat affected zone during the heating part of the weld thermal cycle. It is also possible to minimize that by enhancing cooling rate during friction stir processing. So you use a water jet behind the friction stir tool so that you quench the material and minimize secondary beta precipitation here, right? So we did Liebel hot ductility test, full scale, to compare the liquefaction cracking behavior of the as-cast material with friction stir processed material to assess whether this strategy is useful or not. And the test conditions are given there. They are not very important. Interestingly, in all Liebel hot ductility tests, the as-cast specimens failed without any ductility. Whether liquefaction occurred or not, they failed with zero ductility. The reason is, of course, very obvious. It has a very brittle continuous network of eutectic beta, so fractures at all temperatures occurred in brittle mode with zero ductility. But in the case of friction stir processed samples, the ductility curves were like standard ductility curves. The nil strength temperature of this alloy, friction stir processed alloy, is 487. On heating, nil ductility temperature occurs at 410 degrees centigrade. And as you heat to the nil strength temperature and cool to the text temperature and measure the reduction in area, you find that upon reaching 350 degrees centigrade or so, you recover the ductility sufficiently. That is known as ductility recovery temperature. So overall, from the hot ductility curves itself, we can say there is a very significant improvement in heat affected zone liquefaction cracking resistance. And if you look at the micrographs and fractographs, you further confirm this benefit. For example, in the NST tested as cast material, once again, extensive liquefaction and secondary cracking. That is not to be seen in the friction stir processed sample, same NST specimen. And if you consider this particular fractograph, you see round smooth features, dendrites, on the fracture surface, which tells you that this material, upon cooling to 350 degrees centigrade, still had liquid films persisting along the dendrite boundaries. So at the time fracture occurred, there were still liquid films. That is why we are seeing smooth, rounded features here. But at the same temperature for the friction stir processed material, you see mechanical fracture features, standard intergranular fracture, right? So here again, you can say this is far more resistant to heat affected zone liquefaction cracking as compared to the starting as cast material. Overall, the heat affected zone liquefaction cracking resistance of friction stir processed alloy AZ91 is far superior. First, because of the reduced amount of beta phase, because we are dissolving it during heating from, in one of the earlier slides, you saw the reduction in the amount of beta phase. And secondly, the matrix grain size is very fine, and the low melting second phases are fine and uniformly distributed. So indeed, friction stir processing is a good pretreatment to fusion welding for overcoming heat affected zone liquefaction cracking in materials like AZ91. Now the last case, I'm not going to take much time, maybe 10 minutes, and then we will have some time for discussion, is the use of friction stir processing for selective alloying. Again, a published work. Now, the idea here is to achieve local enhancement in properties by solid state alloying. Alloying is very fundamental to achieving improved properties, right? So if you can do this selectively in solid state, we can achieve superior properties locally. And we used a test case of aluminium and copper. We wanted to alloy aluminium with around 2% copper locally using friction stir processing. So our experiments involved something like this. We made a groove in pure aluminium plate, filled it with copper powder, then did a capping pass without using a pin, and then processed this region again and again until we saw complete elimination of the copper particles. And that is, in this picture you see, after we first friction stir processed, the mixing of copper particles was not thorough. You still see a large number of undissolved copper particles in the stir zone. But when you do second pass, third pass, and fourth pass, the alloying got better and better. And after the fourth pass, there are practically no copper particles left in the stir zone. So all the copper got dissolved into aluminium. So this is solid state alloying, right? Again, here we are talking about alloying due to severe plastic deformation and mechanical mixing. And there is also a role played by diffusion to cause compositional homogeneity over small length scales. So practically no undissolved copper particles after the fourth pass, and we did EDS spot analysis across the nugget, right, along the height, across the width, to find that everywhere the copper content is what we wanted to achieve, around 2%. One important thing here copper content is around 2%, but immediately adjacent to that is zero copper. And this tells something about the mechanism of alloying. If diffusion was playing a major role, we should not see a sharp change in copper concentration, right? If diffusion is really the prominent mechanism or the main mechanism for alloying, this should not be like this. That means alloying is mainly occurring by deformation effects, severe deformation, mechanical mixing. Of course, diffusion also contributes, but its role is mainly in normalizing the copper levels over small length scales. That's not the main mechanism. Now, we did direct aging of this friction stir copper alloyed aluminium. And if alloying is really true, we should be seeing Al to Cu theta prime strengthening precipitates. And that's what we saw in transmission electron micrographs. As you see here, small disc-shaped Al to Cu theta particles, theta prime particles, are seen there in large numbers. And the response was decent. When we measured hardness, we found that there is significant improvement in hardness of the friction stir alloyed region. So this is the hardness of the starting pure aluminium, and this is the hardness of the friction stir processed aluminium without copper addition, and this is the hardness level of the friction stir aluminium alloyed, copper alloyed aluminium in naturally aged condition. And the top one is after artificial aging at 160 degrees centigrade. When you do that, you are achieving reasonably high hardness in the friction stir copper alloyed aluminium, and that should also correspond to higher tensile strength. That's what we saw here. The improvement in strength is quite significant. The strength and both yield strength and ultimate tensile strengths are doubled because of copper alloying and precipitation hardening. So overall, it tells you that friction stir selective alloying is a very effective technique. Now, how can we make use of something like this? Here are some examples of how we can make use of this. For example, it can be used to strengthen these regions where you have stress concentrations. There are some holes right in the plate. These are stress risers. So around the holes, if you have stronger, tougher material, the effect on dynamic properties like fatigue can be improved. So that is one idea. Secondly, if you want to autogenous weld aluminium 4% copper base plates, it's not possible because aluminium 4% copper is highly susceptible to solidification cracking. It is always welded using a high copper containing filler with something like 6.6% copper in the filler, such so that after dilution in the fusion zone, you have a crack safe composition, right? So what can be done here, is along the plate edges, you can alloy a little bit and achieve something like 6% copper level in these regions alone, right? Entire plate is aluminium 4% copper, but locally here you can enhance the copper content. And subsequently, if you do autogenous fusion welding, cracking is not a serious issue. And the third example here is somewhat interesting. If you friction stir alloy in a certain pattern like this and achieve high strength, high stiffness in the processed regions, and the rest of the matrix is relatively soft and ductile, this is hard, strong, maybe stiff, then you can achieve an oxidic behavior in the sheet material. And these oxidic materials have very interesting properties. They have negative, they display negative Poisson's ratio. That means when you extend them, they laterally expand. I mean, this is somewhat interesting behavior. Such sheet materials can conform very faithfully to complex curvatures. Normally, in sheet metal forming, spring back is a big issue, right? You cannot achieve the correct radius of the bend, right? Now, such a sheet can be bent to complex contours very faithfully because it has this oxidic nature. So with that, I would say there are many interesting possibilities with friction stir selective alloying. I have no real experimental evidence for this oxidic behavior, but it is one of the ideas. In future work, we would like to work on something like this. So with that, I end my presentation. As I was mentioning, one of my students, Karthik, is there on the left. He completed his PhD very recently, and he is now working in Tube Products India Limited. And he is a joint student of me and Dr. Ravi Shankar in our department. So I acknowledge their contributions to this work. So now if you have any questions, I will be glad to answer. Yeah. Pardon? Okay. So this deposition is done in ambient atmosphere. So as you deposit, the surface gets oxidized a little bit, and it is not fully flat. It is more or less flat, but there is an oxide layer. So you need to get rid of that oxide layer to ensure that the next layer bonds well with the previous layer. And all you have to do is just surface machining, less than, let us say, 0.1, 0.2 millimeter. That's all. So that is one reason. It is possible to avoid that step by conducting deposition experiments in a protective atmosphere. But it is not typically done. Friction, the strength of friction deposition is its ability to be able to work in ambient atmosphere. Unlike fusion deposition, you really don't need a protective atmosphere. Yeah. There are other fusion techniques. Spray deposition is reported to be successful. In this case, what you do is you mix just before spraying. And during the spray, it quickly solidifies. So the interaction time between the liquid metal and the solid metal is minimal. Right? And even if some interaction takes place, upon spray, they are going to get dispersed, and that is not going to affect the properties very significantly. So spray deposition, there is a patented process on this. I am not able to recall that name, but that is one of the demonstrated techniques for metal-metal composites. No, that actually is quite controllable. Depending on the axial pressure and the traverse speed, rotating speed of the consumable rod, you can control the thickness of the deposit quite closely. Yeah. For a given rotational speed and axial pressure, if you increase the travel speed, your deposit is going to be thinner. Right? Similarly, for a given travel speed and rotational speed, if you increase the axial force, up to some level, deposit thickness increases, but beyond that, the deposit thickness decreases, because now metal gets squeezed out more than what is getting deposited. So it is quite controllable. Yeah. Because you are using consistently the same parameters. That's the control part of it. Explosive welding is very good. Explosive cladding, because it can do large area cladding very easily. 30 meter by 30 meter plate can be cladded in less than a few seconds, right? Setup time is very long, but once you start the process, everything happens within few seconds, right? It's indeed a fraction of a second. But such large area cladding with friction stir is a big task. You cannot really use it for such large clad areas. It has advantages in small coupon sizes. Small area cladding, it is good. Similarly, it is good in selective cladding situations. So you have a big structure, you don't want to clad the entire thing, you want to clad only in specific regions. That is when friction stir is more advantageous. But if you are talking about producing large clad plates, explosive cladding is the best approach. I'm not able to get the for producing metal-metal composites?
Yes, sir.
Yeah?
Sir, we are depositing layer-by-layer and friction stream processing. So, how far is it better than...
Yeah. When you do powder metallurgy technique, your consolidation times and temperatures are very high. You have to use relatively high temperatures and very long times to be able to achieve full density. And this high temperature exposure for very long time is going to result in reaction between the reinforcement metal and the matrix metal. You cannot probably succeed with conventional powder metallurgy route for producing these composites, metal-metal composites. You have to make sure that the exposure time is very little. Exposure temperature also should not be too high. So I would say, compared to conventional powder processing techniques, friction deposition route has much more flexibility in using your reinforcement matrix combinations. In which case? Yeah, of course. Process parameters influence microstructure, distribution of second phases, or distribution of reinforcement particles. We have to ensure not only the process parameters, the pin profile, whether it is straight cylindrical, taper cylindrical, or triangular, right? This will all these features have an effect on the way metal flow occurs in the stir zone. And for good distribution of reinforcement particles, you need to promote both lateral flow as well as thickness direction flow. Yeah, I mean, that's a... actually, you should have asked me this question in a different way. That is, why do you do friction stir processing prior to fusion welding? Why not just do friction stir welding? That is a very pertinent question. But it is not entirely illogical. Friction stir welding is mainly a shop floor process. It cannot be done on-site. Imagine in a certain application, you have to weld on site. We cannot take friction stir welder there, right? But friction stir prior processing, friction stir processing as a pre-treatment can always be done in a shop, right? So you do remotely friction stir processing of the plate edges and then take your plate to on site and then do fusion welding. So it's not entirely illogical.
Is it on site we can do a fusion welding? So, in that case, we have to some buttering operation. So, can we go for a conventional buttering using oxygen welding? What is the difference between that one and
friction buttering? Again, friction buttering is difficult to carry out on site.
Yes.
But it can always be contemplated as a shop floor technique. You can always do buttering on the shop floor for fabrication work. If it is a repair case, it is a different context. Repair has to be done on-site. And for on-site repair, friction deposition is not really a viable technique at the moment. But I'm aware of some efforts directed at developing portable friction deposition machines. And when these portable friction deposition machines come into market, even on-site deposition can be done. They are like your portable stud welder, and such things are expected to be there in near future.
Compared to conventional line, normal steel casting is stick casting process, 12% the same, 20%
Again, I have to ask you to simplify the question. Yeah. Comparison. That stir casting is not possible. If I add high entropy particles to aluminium melt, I won't be actually seeing them as high entropy particles. So that comparison is not even relevant because that is not an applicable technique. Yeah. Problems also multiply with volume percent. In this case, even for 6 volume percent, stir casting is not a viable technique because you are melting aluminium and then adding these particles. So they interact and form undesirable intermetallic compounds, right? Semi-solid processing? I'm not sure. Maybe it is possible, but you have to have a good technique of controlling the distribution. Yeah. And when you talk about semi-solid processing, and you introduce particles in some location, and uniform distribution has to happen only by stirring again, right? And you should not be exposing these particles to high temperatures for too long. In friction deposition, the exposure time is very, very brief. Yeah. Thank you so much.
To close the session or to end the session, I would like to thank Dr. Janakiram. Sir, thank you for sharing the experience and knowledge on friction deposition and friction stir processing and how the heat affected zone crack resistance can be improved with the FD and FSP. Thank you also for sharing some of the case studies where friction buttering was useful for joining dissimilar metals of greater thickness and still retain the ductility and strength properties and also avoid the liquation crack microstructural problems that you experience in the normal fusion welding. Thanks for throwing light on selective alloying using FS process and their potential use. As a token of appreciation, we would like to felicitate Dr. Janakiram. So I call upon Dr. Giridharan, Kumaraguru College of Technology, to felicitate Dr. Janakiram with the memento.